give us an update on the $3,000 on the budget?
Okay, the question was with Bishop and Associates, and rather than try to explain everything that this goes into, I said I'll write up everything in two parts. There's $1,000 that we would pay him for one thing, and $2,000 potentially if we need it for the other. So I split it like that. Second sheet of this is what the software that this conversion does. And I just picked a vacant house on Quaybog Street. So I didn't want anybody getting up in arms because their own house showed up here. So.
What line are we talking about?
I don't remember the line. Dave just asked me to come and talk about the one thing. So I don't. It's called Bishop and Associates.
Consulting service?
Yeah, the consulting. There you go.
What line number is that?
That's my house.
I've actually been squatting in this house for 6 months.
Yeah. You're squatting pretty low. I didn't see you when I looked through the window.
Are you on High Street?
So, in the past, on non-certification years, and that's what we have for the next 3 years, Roy Bishop and his son with him would come in and they would do everything you see under the $1,000 side. Okay, that's the stuff that we need them to do going forward. They handle a lot of communities. We have one gas station, one something else. We don't have any comparisons. So this allows us to see the rest of the world without paying a lot of money to go out and get that data. So he was gonna go up to $2,900 for the service that we have right here for $1,000. I said, because I have a background of going out and looking at houses and doing what's on the next sheet, that I could take that piece over and save us a couple grand and get better data, because I actually get out of the car, walk all the way around the house. So the second piece of this is the state has provided the software for us to maintain these, what's called a property record card. And this the software that they've used, that they developed and they've supported, Charlie Baker came in and said, you know what? Well, I shouldn't say Charlie, somebody on his staff, if not Charlie, said this is not something, the state of Massachusetts does not need to be in the software development and support. So everybody that's been using this, and there's, I don't know, 50, 60 communities in the state, the rug's getting pulled out. So what we need to do is go to another software. The state is proposing something called Tyler, and they said we can swap you over to that for no cost. If we go with some of the other ones, probably cost us $20,000 or so to cut over. They're saying because we can get a good deal because there's a bunch of us going in on it. However, nobody knows how good the data is that's going to come over. So if anybody that's ever been through a software conversion in any kind of low-tech, high-tech situation, if all of a sudden what we're going to have to do when the conversion is done is make sure that this house, that this picture is still here, that it's not a log cabin, that it doesn't talk about a three-bedroom colonial on the drawing on the side, that it doesn't put a 100 by 100 deck on the back of the thing. So there's a lot of questions as to how good the conversion is going to go. So the $2,000 is to protect us. So if this thing gets all out of whack, he can come in and help us put everything back together. Now, because I think there's 18 of the communities that he supports are going through this same process, he's also going to be able to help train us on the new software. And that's going to come at no, just because we're going to be working through this together. So going forward, there will be a $1,000 annual. This line item will be $1,000. This year, it's $1,000 plus the $2,000. And that's what gives us the $3,000.
So next year, to go back down to $1,000, right?
All things being equal.
If everything works out.
Okay. Yep, should be.
So the $2,000 is for...
It's like a parachute. So there's this
what
conversion.
If you needed to use it, what would you be using it for?
Everything under
all that stuff.
Additional stuff.
And that was off the top of my head. I mean, there's a lot to it. And a lot of it we'll be able to do in-house. I mean, there'll be some that, well, obviously we can't. If the thing gets, the problem is, if this thing goes awry when they do the cutover, it'll probably take a weekend. And now we can't trust our data. The longer we go without being able to trust our data, it's going to cost us all. We can't do anything. So now we can say, wait a sec, Monday morning, we got problems. Roy, what are you doing on Tuesday? And get them in here.
When do you foresee this being done, this conversion?
I've asked that we don't be the first and we don't be the last. I want to be somewhere in the middle. Let them work the kinks out. They're saying FY18, probably 75-80%. If not, it'll be FY19. It will not be this fiscal year. They have not put together a project plan yet for all the communities.
Okay. Then this $3,000 is funding that conversion or no?
The $2,000 funds the conversion if needed. It might go seamless.
Right, okay.
And we don't need it. And then I'd be more than happy to say, hey, gang, next spring, here's $2,000. We didn't use it. Boom. Yeah.
So this is a $2,000 insurance policy, essentially.
Perfect way to put it, yes.
It doesn't line up right.
I'm just going to hold the mirror up of the planning board that just walked out of here, okay?
What are you talking about? Excess?
Excess budgeting.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. And how does that play into this?
Well, we don't know. Well, if he doesn't use it, then it's going to go back into it.
Yeah.
Right. So go ahead. Sorry.
I think the difference is, with all due respect to Sharon, if, God forbid, she doesn't get somebody, that's going to have an impact on the planning board. If we don't get this right with the data conversion, stuff like that, we're talking tax rate, we're talking assessments, we're talking all sorts of other significant ramifications that impacts the whole town budget. So, I mean, we got monumental problems. That's why he has a lot of this agita, because we haven't been able to lay our hands on the software. We haven't been able to see it run. We haven't been able to do something and see how it comes out at the other end. Everything is sort of on us. He's been in meetings and webinars where even sometimes the people that are giving the webinar can't answer the question when you ask it. So we've been supplying him with anti-diarrhea medication to get him potentially through.
Well, you're on film there.
I know. But I'm just saying it has significant impact.
This is what the state's recommending, correct?
No, they're mandating.
That's what I want to know. They're going to leave us. The software we use now is going away. If we were to cut over to Vision Patriot, there's a few other homegrown ones. Those are the good ones, Vision and Patriot. Probably looking at $25,000-$30,000 to do it. Right. I would prefer to do that, but I don't think that it makes sense at this point for the town to spend that kind of money. Now, if this thing blows up, I don't know, but I don't know what's going to happen. That's why I don't want to be the first one.
Mandated.
So you can't go to the other ones if you wanted to anyway.
Well, you could, but you're not going to get the group pricing. Right. We're getting what they're doing is
towns,
there's like a 7-year commitment.
What is it, 40 towns initially?
40 towns.
And they promise.
40 was the minimum, went over that. But
did you go up? Okay.
Yeah.
And they promise you can keep your doctor, you can keep your plan, your rates won't go up for 7 years?
It'll go up, there's a cost of living, you know, or whatever in there. But yeah, within reason.
This is the most cost effective remedy that we have.
But the other ones, if you buy the whole thing, and that's what I was wondering.
No, you're not buying, because you're actually buying into like a database stuff is stored out. I wish there was a better way to do it. To your point, Steve, were you going where I don't want to use this money for anything else? I'm not going to use it to balance the budget somewhere else, and I'd be very willing to say it will only be used to support that conversion.
With all due respect, no, that's not where it's going. I'm really going to the discussion we just had
free
with
cash.
The planning board.
Yep.
Okay, over budgeting the line. So I'd like to go back to where, your plan is to take a swing at this, and if all goes well, great.
Yep.
Okay, and that's what $1,000 is for.
No, the $1,000 is an annual thing anyways. That's what helps us set the tax rate, all that stuff. The $1,000 is always there. Would have been $2,900.
Okay. So you're planning on doing this on your own time, on your salary time, correct?
Yes.
Okay, fine. When will you begin this process?
I don't know.
We don't know.
They have to tell us. Right now, they can't show us the software right now.
Okay, they have to tell you.
The software's only set up in a mainframe situation. Okay. They haven't figured out how to, They say they have. I mean, there's, it's like anything.
So I apologize. You are restricted, you still are restricted by, there's a lot you don't know.
MassIT is the one that's running this thing.
MassIT? It's the state, so
Kathy Marks from MassIT will ultimately, she said, I said, just don't put me in the last 10%, don't put me in the first 10%. I want to be in the middle 80s, because the first 10%, Lord knows what's going to happen. The last 10%, they're going to be looking, hey, what's our next project? And they're going to be losing interest, so I don't want to be.
So Al, what if we were to fund this at 50%, okay? Well, hear me out, okay? Don't agree to anything yet.
Well, I wasn't done my sentence. That was only the first word.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. What if we were to fund this at $1,500, okay, for fiscal year 2018, rather than $3,000?
So you see.
It would just hear me out, okay? With the understanding that if it comes to November and you haven't used it, it's still there, that $1,500. And if it comes to, and if it's used in between November and whatever, the spring of 2018, we need to go back to the town and request the money. Now, is that a viable option, first of all?
I don't think so, because what you're saying is I can put 500 towards this 2,000.
I was going to say, well, right? It's two different things.
Because I got the 1,000 that I have to pay.
Okay, good point. Yep. So, okay, very
so
good.
So 2,000 maybe total, where you pay this 1,000 and then you're paying half of this.
There you go. Yeah.
So now.
What you can do, Al, if you really want to talk about this free cash, unforeseen, you can use the reserve fund. The reserve fund is for unforeseen. You don't know if this is going to go through or not.
So if you have a screw up,
he knows it's going to go. He just doesn't.
Right, but if there's a screw up and you don't know that there's going to screw up, then you can technically say that could come out of the reserve fund, unforeseen, or you can fund it the way you're doing it.
If you ask me how I'm most comfortable, I'm most comfortable with what's on paper. If they say in August, that it's going to, they could say next week, or they could say in June that it's going to happen in August. I have no control over that now.
Sure.
If I have to wait for November, No.
If you don't have that money in the fund that you're asking for now.
If I'm understanding, that's right. This is going to happen.
It's going to happen.
It's going to happen. And if you don't have the money there and it's a screw up, you can come and get it out of the reserve fund.
At any time.
So I can pick up the phone.
Unforeseen.
Things went awry last night.
Like Steve said, you don't know if you're going to use that money or not.
Well, but as long as he's looking for quick access.
Yeah.
He wants to just make sure the money is there.
I'm looking for
it. The state is going to be in this group of towns.
Well, the state's running the whole thing, which is what scares me right there. So.
Oh yeah, that's a problem. But how much are you putting in there just in case something goes wrong?
$2,000.
Okay, so what I'm saying is if everything goes smooth, you're not going to use the $2,000. If something goes haywire, you don't know it's going to go haywire, then you can come to this board and we'd have you the difference.
I will, whatever you folks want to do is.
Those are the two options.
This is my first time in the town of Brookfield going through the budget process.
Right.
I understand what you're trying to do. You're trying to keep it low. I don't want, my worry would be down the line if we have to go to a special town meeting or something.
You won't have to.
And it gets voted down or anything like that.
You won't have to.
If you folks are all comfortable with saying that $2,000 isn't needed, that I can, at any point on demand, I can call up and say, I'm in trouble, I need it. As long as everybody understands that at some point.
What you're saying is now, you're just like, that's like having $2,000 in the reserve fund is what you're doing.
I talked to Roy, I said, what do you think?
That's my question.
And he said, I'm telling everybody to put $2,000 in. All the community.
Can I
ask you this? West Brookfield, North Brookfield.
Okay. Now, Al, I have a question for
you. Sure.
This $2,000, is there a retainer that we need to pay Bishop,
no.
Something the one, that they want.
No, he's been doing business with us for years.
Yeah,
he would be very, very good. Yeah. I bet he's been working here for 20, 25 years.
Okay.
started as a contractor and his own company.
Right, so I'm just trying to wrap my head around what this $2,000 is for. I understand, Steve, what you're saying. I think I have, right, and I understand that. I have a similar issue that it sounds like you have. If we run into a situation where things go sideways and we don't have the funding there, it does sound like we're all in agreement that the money
is here within a week.
May I finish my thought?
Yeah, I'm sorry, yeah.
No, so, yeah. My point being that if this is what is being recommended to municipalities, and it sounds to me like Bishop and Associates is recommending this, if something happens and that balance of the $2,000 isn't available, the $1,000 I think we can all agree is, you know,
you have to have it.
Thank you. Yeah,
the $2,000 is the only question here, but if it's being recommended that they have that in there, and at the end of the year it goes back into free cash, we run into the same situation again. I think the only thing that would offer me maybe a little more of a level of comfort would be to know that there is an assurance that there would be that funding, level of funding that we would need, so that if this thing goes sideways, they can make it happen.
It pretty much sounds like this is going forward to me.
It is. But whether it goes sideways or not is where the $2,000 comes in. If they run into these conversion issues, which it looks to me like you've listed down here.
This was off the top of my head.
I got you.
More than likely, if there's an issue, I didn't put it down.
Right.
It's going to be
something
reporting
unforeseen.
Or something.
Yeah.
I just tried to come up with some ideas as to what could go wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And now, all of a sudden, you're calling because you don't have a casino in your backyard, but you're getting, you know, we have you down for that. I mean, it's... This, in my mind, this is one of the most critical things that's done every year for the town, ongoing, is to make sure that all the data on all of 1,562 parcels in the town of Brookfield is accurate. And I just that's what I'm entrusted with. I don't want that to go sideways or anywhere. I don't even want to do this change.
Right. Mm-hmm. We have to.
Now, yeah. The other thing that I was thinking is the reserve fund is $25,000. And I'm playing devil's advocate here. If there were any other kind of emergency in town unforeseen, could wipe out that $25,000 and that money would not be accessible. It wouldn't be there. Who knows what act of God or nature or whatever, you know, could happen. And then that's going to leave him without that money. So where else would he get that money from? Being that it's only $2,000, and being that this information is, and this being how important this information is, and bearing in mind all the other issues about over budgeting, you know what I mean? This is an absolute necessity. And if anything goes wrong, we're all in big trouble. So personally, I would rather just put the $2,000 there. We know it's going to happen either 18 or 19. What we're really looking for as far as overfunding is something that's been going on for years, not maybe a one-time event.
Right.
We're looking for departments that have been consistently over budgeting. And this is a one-time thing. You know, I personally don't have a problem with it just because it's so important.
Yeah, I'm in favor of the $2,000 there too, myself.
Do you
want to make a
it.
Motion to accept the $3,000?
I'll make that motion.
So we're reconsidering the motion to fund. No.
No, it's $3,000. No. We're just.
Yeah,
just
we haven't this. Even done this right. one yet. Okay.
Exactly.
So you're the motion?
No, I made the motion.
Okay,
yeah.
And I'll second it.
Any further discussion,
Bob? You did.
Who did
Bob
it? Who Bob did? Okay. All right. I didn't.
Bob,
hear.
Discussion?
Yeah.
Further discussion?
I'm going to take a different tact. I think we've got to be careful because I can see a trend line running here that I'm getting a little nervous about, not only because it's him, but that. Kerry comes in and says, we got over budgets, bring them down, whatever it is. Okay,
right.
Fine.
Yep.
Because that's going into free cash. Planning comes in now, we'll cut what they want. and then we can always go back into reserve funds if you need it.
No, you can't do reserve funds from
all right, whatever. But wages, they, now we're going into, oh, whatever, wages or whatever. Now we're going into some other account. We can do that. Plan, assessor comes in and says, I need this. Now, if you're a little bit over, cut you in half. Well, we can always go into another fund at the end and come in. We're starting a model here. I don't know if that's where we want to go.
No, I don't think we are, Bob.
Okay, well, I'm just saying what's going to happen. I mean,
it's definitely.
We shut that down. Huh? I think we just shut it down here.
I know that, but I'm just saying.
Right.
As a macro,
I saw it the same strategy myself.
That people are going to say, fine, right. I'll go in with a high number. I know they're going to knock me down in half,
right.
But then I can always go into this other account at the end of the year. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to strategize where I'm just going to blow it up first, get backed off, go in the thing, and then I'm going to have a major catastrophe at the end of the year, and then I go back and I still get what I wanted the first time.
I would posit to you that may have been going on to some degree all along anyway.
But Bob,
not that that's a good thing.
You're not looking at the crunch here. The plan we took the planning board. I'm just going to say the planning board had money in there for a long period of time, so that was a whole different.
I realize that.
That had nothing to do with Al. It's two different animals you're talking. Two different animals.
Right, but you understand what he's saying.
Oh yeah, but I'm saying that there's no model going on here.
We're talking about people.
Well, it's a trend. It's a trend line. Huh?
Well, if you want to say the trend, then you can say that's been going on for years in this town, and that's why this board is trying to knock off this free cash over budgeting. That's what we're trying to do. Okay, so we're all in favor?
Talking about the same thing from different
perspectives. Yeah.
We all in favor on this?
Yeah, I am.
Steve, you got something else?
I'm voting no.
Okay.
Okay.
I have to recuse, don't I?
You have to abstain.
Abstain, excuse.
Do you have to?
I don't know.
So it passes.
Okay, so we have all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
No.
Yep.
No, one abstain.
Could I, first off, I want to thank everybody. Yeah. And if I have to come back again, I'll come back 500 times and do it again.
We don't want to waste your time.
Here's my question.
We've seen you enough.
Let's say that they come through and they say, we're going to do this in October. And so the first week of October, we do this conversion. Mm-hmm. By the first week of November, I say, you know what? I feel good. What do I do? Do I come back and say, I don't need that $2,000?
Nope.
Or do we just let the chips ride till the end of the year?
And it goes into free cash.
And then whatever's left in there rolls back into free cash.
That's okay. Correct.
And frankly, I wouldn't trust the state enough to ever say that until the process were totally complete.
that's what worries me.
Not that I don't trust your judgment, but I don't trust the state, so.
If it was anybody else, a private entity, I'd be a lot more comfortable because I know that then I can say, hey, in the contract it's stated, I don't have that luxury right now, so I know we have to do it. Yeah. Is this somebody else's stuff right here?
No.
That's
just
extra?
There.
Okay.
We'll leave that for Mary. Barbara, I mean.
Okay, yeah, that's what I meant, so that's part of our
She's taking care of her husband.
Thank you very much, folks.
Great question.
Thank you for pointing that out.
Anytime. Don't be a stranger. You know where the office is.
I'm not a stranger in there.
No, you're not.
All right, let's move on to the agenda for the fire chief's budget, seeing that we have the fire chief here.
I'm glad you understand what I'm saying.
I do.
Yeah, we didn't vote in. We took the data in.
Well, people come in, they'll highball it, realizing that they're going to get hamstrung, and then I know because I do it almost every day, but the opposite. I see it every municipal bids.
Everybody have
people
the fire chief's budget
low.
In front? Yes.
Get the bid, and then
I don't have it on.
You probably don't.
No, that's what I'm saying.
Who needs a copy?
I do.
I do,
did I make any changes? I'm going to pass that down to Tony for status. And who else needs one?
Hey, please.
Anybody else?
I do as well.
Okay.
Unless I have one in here, and I very well might.
I'll make you one, Bill. Give that to me.
want to give me one too?
Yep. Who else needs one down here?
Steve, you okay?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Anybody else?
You got one?
Yes, sir, all set.
Okay. Steve, were you here? We had the discussion.
Yes, it was.
Yep. Anyone not here? Okay, so.
I wasn't, but I watched it on TV.
Okay.
Okay. So we're going to do line 880. The discussion was from the fire chief that he wanted to bring up his guys to 17 an hour. Or we can just leave it the way it is, level funded. So that would be the first discussion from all of you. It's supposed to go to the personnel board, but I don't know if we're gonna have time for that, or to see how you people wanna view it.
We had asked him for more information from other towns, if I recall.
If I may throw this in?
Throw it at us.
Okay, I have three notes, three bits of homework.
Yeah.
We asked Chief Martel to find info on pay structures and scheduling from other towns, number one. We asked Chief Martel for a detail of his expenses of his department. That was homework number two. And then homework number three was our own homework. And that was to find out about minimum wage and whether or not the town requires us following minimum wage payment.
We don't have to follow it from what I understand.
Nope.
We don't have to follow minimum wage.
According to who?
Copeland Bay.
Town attorneys. So that's that answer. The other two of the chief.
Haven't we sat here and talked about it? It's got to be $11 or $12 because that's minimum wage.
What we were basing it on.
Right.
We didn't have to.
We didn't have to.
But
right.
We thought, in the interest of fairness, that would be a good thing to do.
So no municipality needs to follow the minimum wage law of $11 an hour, $11.50, or whatever it is right now.
Nothing.
Pounds are exempt.
That's crazy.
It is what it is.
So, Pete, what do you got for us?
Okay.
I guess this is the budget.
Yep.
Time, so, right.
We can move this along.
I mean, it's just funny.
Well, that's for you.
You have a statement on wages. You know what I mean?
Oh, good.
Or the wording on it.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I do.
Okay.
Is it okay if I turn the heat down below 90?
Yes, go right ahead.
Okay.
Usually
that's
thermostat.
What's it up?
You get like 88, Pete. We appreciate it.
It's 72.
Excuse me. So we want to pass along money.
I kind of thought
70
something raised.
Usually the thermostat isn't working.
This is the budget. You just.
Is the thing working?
Did you make an extra one?
It seems like it's working good.
For what?
Go ahead.
Turn up to 70. Go up to 70.
Can we pass these along? Make sure we get them.
So I did revise based on some of the figures.
Who else needs one?
You?
The single page.
What's that?
The single page you're seeing, I did revise it down to $16 an hour based on some feedback and just some discussion internally that, you know, maybe the jump at 17 was a bit much in the first year of implementation after 5 years of discussion, but the overall structure remains the same. It's just the rate. And then the multi-page document you have is based on feedback from the towns listed, with the exception of Wales, who's put in the chart but never didn't get back to us in time.
So the multi-page document is the first thing.
That's a multi-town comparison.
Multi-town comparisons, and then the detail of expenses is.
Detailed expenses I didn't do. I didn't remember that part from meeting last.
This document then is what?
That's a proposed pay schedule that would go into effect if funded.
That's less money that was originally proposed.
Yeah, we dropped it down to $16 an hour rather than 17.
On the training, if I remember correctly from watching the video, 10 people on average is average, right?
Thereabouts, yeah.
That's what it is, yeah.
Yep. Okay.
Chief of Mount Fania, this and this are same, they just look different?
No, this, that was the original budget as submitted.
Correct.
Which was level funded per the request.
Correct.
This is the proposed, but the proposed wages, which encompasses lines 880 and 885. Since the previous, okay. Since the previous so, one was just training.
So.
Have to look at this, correct?
Before you approve it, no.
No, well, the personnel board doesn't have to look at this?
No, not before you do, no.
Well, I mean, I would hate to make a recommendation against, you know.
No, the personnel board, if funded, would make the guidance towards the
rate.
Just approving the funding mechanism and the rate, and there will, coming up at their meeting, and just the early response from a couple members was a tiered system with various rates depending on experience. But again, we can't guarantee who is going to attend training or call, so using 16 as a top, which is even low. When you look at the multi-town chart, firefighters per hour, everybody's above us.
But what kind of hours, what kind of departments do they have?
Every department listed is the same as Brookfield, the call department.
I mean, they're not call departments, I mean, yeah?
Every department listed is a call department, yes. There are no career departments between the town of Ware and Worcester. Even Sturbridge is a combination of career members and call members.
And East Brookfield must be as well, because I don't see them on
East Brookfield here. Didn't reply in time for the chart, but they're a call department as well. I don't have their specific figures, but they do get paid for calls and they are a call department. And just looking down the chart, you know, with the exception of New Braintree, which was added later in the game to replace another town, it's alphabetical, and in each category, the Brookfield is the lowest by far, and when you factor out the fact that Brookfield doesn't get paid for any calls, it even more so.
Okay, but you're figuring calls in now with this sheet you've presented.
Yes.
And I do recall we also asked that you come up with some kind of structure for determining at least a baseline for how many people would be required to respond. We were looking for some sort of controls.
Of all the towns that I polled about that, nobody had any answer for that because nobody's ever run into a problem with that. In fact, town of Brimfield said on average during the day they can get 3 people. Other towns have said that creating a company system where only certain people are on duty on the call department is troublesome because even if people are available, they have other things to do in their lives. They have childcare, they have appointments, things. So if we're lucky enough to get people during the day because they work nights, then that affects. So nobody's indicated that it's ever been a problem or an issue with overstaffing on calls.
Well, I'd like to see, I mean, for our town, I'd like to see if we're gonna even implement something like that. I'd like to see some kind of control. I mean, coming from a financial point of view from this board, I'd like to see some kind of control.
Okay, we want to limit the number of people that come to fires.
No. I'm talking about an accident. Basically, accidents is what I'm referring to. Not fires.
Yeah, but you can't. It's hard to break it down like that then.
May I? The way I recall this part of our conversation, it was specific to evenings and weekends, because during the day people have jobs and whoever's available shows up, okay? And but if it's a Saturday, and there is a schedule of 8 people who are available to show up for anything, and those 8 show up, that's fine. If 20 guys show up, well, that's not fine. Okay? That was the orientation, as I recall, of our request for a schedule outline. So, you know, what are other towns doing with this? Evenings, weekends. That's how I recall our request to you.
Yeah. And again, the towns that responded back have no such system because they can't. It's never been an issue, and they've never ever felt the risk of limiting the number of people that will respond. So we'd be creating a system, the first out of the state, if not larger, that would do it, because we don't know who's going to make it on any given time, even nights.
Well, you must have some sort of record of, I don't know, you must keep, obviously, if they're going to, you must know who's there. There must, do you do attendance at any way?
Yes.
Like, yeah.
Yes.
No, you got to do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I don't.
For training.
Legal fire report, yeah.
Well, for training, but well, I'm talking about actual.
Up. Oh, yeah. He has to do that too.
I just don't know how they operate, if there's a sign in or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not talking a lot of money.
I'd just like to weigh in that I think having that kind of control, if you will, I think that sets a bad precedent for us as a town, and I'm not in favor of that. I think that if 20 people show up to a fire or an accident,
no, we're talking, referring to accidents only.
Okay, so yeah. if more people show up to an accident, I don't think it's our business to
dictate. Well, I'm just bringing it up for discussion.
Sure,
I wouldn't
be in favor of that, because I can only imagine it's probably challenging enough to get enough people to show up to an incident at times,
daytime.
Nights and weekends and daytimes. And
weekends
whatever.
Are a little better. Daytime is tough.
Right. Exactly.
And where he is.
Need to go?
No.
Where he's saying that he hasn't found that is that kind of a problem with other towns, you know?
It's not existing.
Huh?
He said there was no problem.
Yeah. So.
And you know, if I could weigh in for a second, I worked with Peter for a couple of years back when I was younger on the fire department, and I think if there was ever a call of any kind in this town, the 20 guys showed up. I think everyone would be doing backflips. This is a small town, and people have lives outside of here. They have jobs. People do travel outside of the Truman Show here in town, and to be close enough to respond to a call, you know, it's you typically don't get a lot of guys, and I think it's about damn time these guys start getting paid for what they do. Just my opinion, but I think it is. And I think as far as limiting calls, you know, we talk about a car accident, you know, a lot of car accidents come back to me in my head that I've been in. And I can tell you, I've stood on the trunk of a car with four other guys and helped peel back a roof while two other guys were cutting the braces, and there's seven guys, you know, plus other guys were pulling people out of cars. We were mutual aid in the North Brookfield. They didn't have enough bodies to pull people out of cars. So I think if we try to set any kind of precedence as to how many people can show up and get paid or whatever, what I think is going to happen is A, we may end up putting ourselves in a legal issue because we didn't have enough people on hand to provide for however many people were hurt or whatever, my opinion. And B, if we start saying only so many guys can show up, then, you know, people start hearing chatter on the radio, and then there's already enough guys. And
well,
then
that's why we were talking about a schedule.
But to schedule people on a call department stuff, too, because a lot of these guys have jobs and other things, and things come up. So I just want to weigh my, I wanted to put my two cents in. You know, I think that, you know, it's not a, it's a very thankless job, and it's a very hard job. And
I don't think it's thankless. But
well,
they're definitely not thankless.
This
job is thankless.
Well, this job may be, but trust me, I think these guys do a lot more than people realize, and I just think that we don't ever have enough guys, you know, and I don't know how it is nowadays, but just from what I've seen, there's not a whole nother rack of gear on that wall, so I don't think they had double the amount of guys they had back in the day. I'm guessing they're probably still working on the same amount. We had 20 or 25 guys back then.
We had more back then. We're
at
24
rostered
now.
There you go. So I just want to put my opinion in. I think it's such an important thing, you know, it's the safety of the homes and lives in this town. So, again,
financially, the town's been getting away with an incredible bargain over the last 20 years since most towns started fully compensating to any degree. And when you look at that chart even, I mean, the one that jumped out at me was my counterpart in the town of Hardwick. Makes $25,000 a year as a call chief. And even then you drop down, you know, just the firefighter rates are all around the $14-16 an hour range. West Brookfield is for as high as $19 an hour depending on qualifications. So 16 is not unreasonable, and then the other positions, we're well within that. So,
do these other chiefs serve on EMS to the extent that you do?
No, because my case is kind of unique because I work for EMS full time during the day, and I have certain responsibilities that bleed over into it. The closest comparison would actually be the town. Oh, unfortunately, they're not in there. The East Brookfield chief makes about $15,000 a year, and he's a call chief also, and he also has full-time people that do support stuff during the day. So in Brookfield's case, I'm a call chief that has somebody doing support stuff during the day. It's just me. But my fire chief salary covers the rest of the time. The nights, weekends, meetings, etc.
Right, now when they put you into that position back in the day, mm-hmm. that was the agreement, you were going to do the EMT and be the fire chief at the same time.
No.
And then when you're doing the EMT, you also get 6 hours a week, correct? As an EMT. Don't you get 6 hours a week?
What do you mean 6 hours?
That's built in. No, no, I'm talking about he's an EMT, but he's also the fire chief at the same time when they built that position for you.
No, no, that's not how they built the position.
Okay,
the position is firefighter EMT.
Right.
Yes, who happens to be the fire chief. The fire chief's pay is completely separate, paid by the town. The firefighter EMT position is funded by EMS.
Right.
So it's two different positions.
Right.
So I get paid 40 hours a week, and then 2.5 hours of overtime a week to be on call because I'm actually my schedule. I'm available for calls 60 hours a week,
right.
40 while I'm working, and then 4 hours a day where I have to be available. I'm available from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m.
Right.
So, and that had nothing to do with being fire chief.
Well, when they did the position, from what I understand, it was all put in there together. But
well, then you understand it wrong because it isn't.
Okay.
I was the fire chief who applied for a job as a full-time firefighter paramedic. So it's two separate positions.
Right, no, I know, I understand it's two separate positions, but it was all with that framework. That's why they set it up that way, back in the day.
You can't double dip either.
Right. We're the ones that broke, you have a fire chief line separately. This board did that like 5 years ago.
Yeah, I never quite understood that, but.
Well, it's a separate, just what you said, it's a separate position.
Oh, right, but there are very few.
You're working at the same time, you're over there doing the EMT, and you're doing that kind of at the same time, and there's nothing going on. That's how I was told. When you're over there, you had time to do the fire chief, and it was kind of like a good thing for the town.
So during the day then?
Unless that's changed.
Are you scheduled as EMT during the day?
Yes, that's my job.
No, I get it, but then when do you put in do things like inspections and stuff?
As part of my full-time job, I do the majority of inspections during the day, but a lot of inspections are done off hours, weekends to accommodate the customer, the resident.
It's not just the First Amendment rights.
So if you're, well, you'd always have your your radio with you anyway, if you were doing an inspection during the day, you would get, you'd have to leave naturally.
Yeah, yes, and go.
Yeah. All right.
Couple of, so you pointed out hardware at $25,000.
Yeah.
This man, this person, this fire chief in Hardware, might be a woman.
No,
or ladies.
No,
you're right. Okay. This person has a full-time job, 40 hours a week, plus this thing of fire chief. Is that?
I don't know what Ray does for a full-time job. But
you don't know?
No, he's a call chief, and that's what he makes on that.
And this is the emergency squad budget you're in here somewhere, right?
Yes.
Okay. Yep. Good enough. As an EMS and a fire guy in there.
Yeah, the job description covers duties supporting both of those.
What's the issue here? Okay. Yeah, look here.
All right, so we're on the fire chief. I'm going to give you. Peter, what do you ask? Actually, okay. So, what are you requesting to this board right now? As far as you being the fire chief.
Well, I'm trying to do the single page. I was looking at the fire chief wage is going to $7,000, and then the balance of that single sheet, 53 and change, being the rest of the staff and the assistant chief.
So yeah, I see it now.
Everything above this line?
The second line proposed would go to 7,000. The first line would be 73,968.
In other words, this plus this plus this plus this plus that.
Yeah, the first line on that sheet is this line.
Is that could line, have been that right. clear. Okay, yeah.
And the second line is everything else.
Everything else, yes. Got it. Yeah.
I'm looking on the next page, and you have the, okay, I'm seeing nothing listed on here for, okay, you got annual, all right. But you, on the first page for the different positions, the Brookfield annual chief, you have yours there, and assistant fire chief, there's an entry on the first page. Deputy fire chief, do you have a deputy fire chief?
We do not, no.
You do not? Okay. And on the next page, you have nothing for fire captain.
He makes $12 an hour for training.
Okay, I'm just wondering why that wasn't. And so for training, so there's no annual.
No annual stipend for that position.
It wouldn't be a stipend. It would be a.
I thought you paid hourly then, evidently.
Yeah. Yeah, if he gets paid hourly, so there should be a figure there for an estimate, right? For the amount of training you do every year?
What do you do, quarterlies? They get it every 3 months, they get something?
Yes.
Everyone?
We do payroll every 3 months.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what's entailed in somebody getting 3 months? What's in that 3 months?
$12 an hour for the amount of training they did.
Okay.
All right, so by the quarter, you do how many? Well, that's if they show up, too. Right. Right.
Yes. If they do training, they are paid $12 an hour.
All right. So if they came to every training, how much would that be a month? How many? Was it 2 hours a week?
If they made every training in-house, minimum $144, but we have people attend training elsewhere. So example, that this quarter and the last quarter, there was one fire lieutenant who made more in that quarter than the fire chief did, because he attended more training. And
okay, well, I'm just talking about this particular position. How many hours of training per quarter? So if it's two hours a week,
minimum 2 hours a week, I dare say 3 times 12. So you're looking at people make four trainings a month, you're looking at $144 a quarter.
Well, 8 times 3 is 24, 3 months, 8 hours a month. So that's $296 a quarter. And $12 an hour. Okay, just so there's a figure there. And you have any fire, I thought you had fire lieutenants, no?
We do, they make $12 an hour.
How many do you have?
Two.
Okay,
but that's why that column has an hourly rate in it and not the stipends, because in those two cases the only town that does the stipend is West Brookfield, who gets a stipend and the hourly rate. The
okay,
other towns,
well, I'm just asking why it's blank, that's all. Okay.
Are the other towns hourly rates for training only as well?
No. Oh no, no. Every other town listed gets paid for calls and training. So yeah, that was an oversight on my part for the three positions on the second page of the multi-page document. Brookfield should have been listed at $12 an hour.
So, and that's just for training?
Yes.
And then firefighters
that one's listed. Yep.
Get $12 an hour. Yeah, because on the front page you did figure it in, I guess. For training, 52 weeks times 4 hours times 10 people.
Yep.
Because that's the average number that show up.
Yeah.
And so 52 weeks times 4 hours. Where'd the 4 hours come from? If it's, you said it's an average of 2 hours
a
week?
It's anywhere from 2 to 3 to 4 hours on Monday nights. But that also gives the buffer for off hours training when we do go out on, when we have the opportunity to go out on Saturdays, somebody attends a program at either one of the two fire academies or a program in another town.
And how often does that happen? Programs in other towns and that sort of thing?
I had two officers at the academy for 4 hours earlier this week. People attend some trainings in other towns depending on the benefit scene. The academy runs training other sessions. It's the training schedule set up by the Mass Fire Academy is good. It's just it's not with any great regularity, and nobody's going to drive to West Barnstable for something. So it's not really foreseeable. It's when we have a program that's reasonable to attend based on location that we do that. I mean, again, 5 years of talking about this, first year of implementation would be the good one to
just work on. All right, and how long, what's the average amount of time the firefighters that you presently have, like how much experience do they have?
You want an average?
Well, how many like really new guys do you have?
Oh, just turning in their paperwork, we have two, and we have two with about a year's experience, and then several within the 1 to 5 year range, like a couple in the 5 to 10 year range, quite a few from the, well, several from the 10 to 20 year range, and then you've got, you know, Amit coming up on 30 years, Mr. Chavey's at 37 years. So we've got a few in the 25 to 35 range easily, probably six of them.
What position is Mr. Chavey?
Assistant chief.
Assistant chief.
What's the difference between a deputy and an assistant fire chief?
It's subjective to the department. It's usually just a ranking structure. If you want more basically upper management and command role, but you want to differentiate between the two. In the past, we have had an assistant chief and a deputy chief, but we haven't had it for some time.
So what's the difference as far as their roles?
They both have the same roles. It would be their responsibilities when there wasn't a fire, just in terms of how much they would step in the administration running of the department. Yeah. But in terms of fire command, they would take on the same exact role in the absence of someone above them.
Uh-huh. So you could call assistant fire chief a deputy chief if you, you know.
Good. Well, if he takes on administrative duties.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It's just a way, if you have a larger department, of breaking down ranks to give it more of a tiered system.
Mm-hmm. So I guess I'm a little confused at what's at issue here. We seem to be going down a number of different rabbit holes, and I'm not convinced I understand what the issue is.
Two issues. They want to get paid for calls. That's one.
Right.
They want to get more per hour. That's the second one. Those are the two issues.
Okay. Well, the second issue as far as the rate, I think we've sort of, that's a personnel board matter as far as rates go.
Well, we can weigh in, and then they can weigh in as well.
Right.
From my point, from just me now, I dedicate myself to this town a lot. I was on the culture council. I did a lot of physical work there.
Right.
I didn't get paid. I'm on the planning board. I don't take a stipend. I'm on this board doing this relentlessly. There's a lot for me to do. I don't get paid. And the firemen, they should get paid something, yes. They're dedicated guys. When I say dedicated, they're out there for the townspeople. That's my attitude of them.
Yeah.
And someone said it's a thankless job. I don't think so. I think people appreciate those guys. I really do.
Well, I think,
but should they get from a big jump like this to the next to the big jump? That's something you can. I'd say give them something, but to take a drastic jump.
So what's that issue here? Is the difference between $12 and $17?
$16.
$12 and $16. Yeah.
Okay.
And if they get paid on the calls.
Yeah.
$50,000. $50,000. And Peter, what are you looking to? And then you're looking for what you said on here. You're looking to go from. You're looking to double your pay almost, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Those are the three issues that we have at hand.
$50,000.
What's the $50,000 represent?
The increase.
The difference, not, right?
The increase.
The increase.
Yeah.
I think it's more than.
You mean 50?
Except that it's not.
Okay.
Yeah. About $50,000.
$50,000 from where we're at.
No, yeah.
Which is not reflected on any piece of paper we got.
No, you'd have those. You'd right. Go to you'd have my to, budget sheet.
You have to add.
Yeah.
Have to add this page.
Yeah, that plus, and then the two.
Plus,
yeah.
Yeah. Well,
two
for us. 585.
Right. Yeah. Yep.
Okay. So I guess the first thing you guys want to entertain is if they want to get paid for the calls, right? Accidents and fire.
Right. Yeah.
Now, you used to get paid for brush fires, but then you didn't get paid for them, and you got paid for training. You used to get paid for brush.
We
went from not getting paid for brush, but you get paid for training.
There was an archaic system that nobody really knows the.
Well, I was on the board 7 years ago, and you got paid for brush fires.
Right, and nobody could ever understand why that was the only thing that we got paid for. So we stopped doing that, went to a stipend system. And that didn't fairly reflect activity, so we started paying on training using the same bucket of money.
Right.
And then that would reflect people's activity within the department. If everybody got a stipend, then you could never show up and get the same amount.
Exactly.
If you got showed up for training, that was reflected.
And the ones that show up for training are obviously really entrenched
exactly.
In the fire department because they want to learn.
Yeah, they've got the most interest, enthusiasm, activity,
right. And experience for
yeah.
When
so it reflects across. People. Yeah.
Right. Yep. Okay.
So the comment was made that on no piece of paper here in front of us is there showing them what that increase would be.
Well, you've got the single page distributed tonight, and then the first two lines on the original submitted budget. So if you add up the first two lines on the original submitted budget, that gives you the total versus the total that on the sheet that was handed out tonight.
Which is,
if I could
illustrate. Let me try.
Okay,
to
yeah, go ahead.
Follow the bouncing ball.
Yeah.
And it is bouncing.
And this is nothing new. We've been talking about this for 5 years.
Plus those two lines.
So
no, just the opposite.
This is 34.
It's this sheet plus this everything below it.
Okay.
Right.
This is saying 37, but that says 34.
One you're looking at. Yeah, that's a typo, I think.
For the fire chief annual, you have for Brookfield $37.46, but on the budget it says $34.76.
No, that must have been a typo then.
I think that's a
so
transcription
it should be,
error.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm just worried. You know, yeah. Looking at the final.
So it's got it there too, so it's in both. No.
I think that's the error.
I think that's
the spreadsheet is the error.
All right, so it should be 34.
Right. 3476 is the actual amount. 3746 is the
fire chief salary. 3476, yes.
Okay. That, this to transfer.
Yes, what you've got on yours, on your original sheet, the multi-page document distributed tonight was actually a transcription.
So why don't we take right now to the board? Do you want the firemen to go and get paid to car accidents, truck accidents, and fires? I guess that's our first question.
What about brush fires?
Well, calls.
Well, I'm just trying to list them all down
so you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And brush fires. Right. That's our first question to the board.
Yep.
Then what we're going to do after that, we'll discuss per hour.
Right.
So, who wants to open up the table if they get paid?
I'd like to make a motion that they get paid for all calls.
Okay. Well, someone want to second that for discussion?
I will second that for a discussion.
Okay.
So, we're not talking about the pay rate at
not
this
right
point.
Not right now.
We're talking about getting paid. So, currently, I want to make sure that I got this right.
They're just getting paid for training, Steve.
Which is 52 times... 52 weeks times 4 hours times 10 people, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
And if I were to multiply that by 12 rather than 16, I would get currently what we're spending on that. Is that right?
Roughly, yes.
Roughly.
That's more reflected in your page here.
The 21.
Yeah, the 21.5.
Okay.
I don't know if the math is exact based on the figures.
Okay, so that's fine. So we're talking about taking this agreeing to pay for calls. We're talking about doubling the budget because we're going from 21.5 to 21.5 plus, based upon Chief Martell's figures here. 120 calls, 2 hours, 6 people. That's $16 an hour.
Yeah. If you held it at 12, obviously it would be less.
It'd be less. Yeah. Okay, so.
But one issue at a time.
Right.
Yep.
So I'm just going to do that. Times 2, times 6, times 12, right? 12. So we're talking about adding $17,280 to the budget right there. So that's the number figure. There's a moral issue here. Do we want to pay firefighters to go on calls? And there is a...
That question sounds even odd to ask, doesn't it?
I'm oftentimes...
Well, given the history of the town,
don't pick my words correctly.
See, I always, from my point of view, old school, I always thought the guys would, you know, just dedicated their time. I didn't know they got actually paid, you know, when they volunteer. I mean, that's just in my head. And then Peter set me straight. Call means it's a new name, but they get some kind of benefit, some kind of financial, which I don't have a problem with that either.
Right. There are only 13 purely volunteer departments in the state.
How many?
13.
Okay.
And we're not one of them. And we're good.
No, because of that $12 an hour for training.
Right.
If you make $1 a year as a stipend, you become a call firefighter.
Okay, so that's the differential when you get paid, you're a call.
Yes.
Okay.
So, Steve, I'm sorry. So,
Steve, go ahead. Yeah.
I didn't mean to interrupt, but what's at issue here is whether or not folks get paid to respond to a call.
That's absolutely how I'm understanding it.
Right.
I think aspects of our debate, as I see it being sort of framed up here, is do we want to pay firefighters to do? I don't want to say this the wrong way.
I believe there is an aspect of volunteerism and altruism that goes into choosing to be a firefighter.
That's where I'm at. Yeah.
Okay. And I'm not sure how you say, well, we'll compensate you for half of your goodwill, but not the other half of your goodwill. So it seems to me that we're, by saying we're going to pay for calls, well, we're paying for calls. And the dollar figure to that is essentially a doubling of that fire of line 880. You know, like right off the bat. Now that's the financial implications.
Why is it 33.5 and on here it's 32.80?
Okay. So the numbers. Let me ask this question, Chief. May I ask this question? Where have the, just for example, line 880 fire wages?
Yes.
Where has that line item run as far as funding goes? Underfunded? About the right amount?
It's been about the right amount since we started funding training, etc.
Okay. So that's a good number.
That's a good number based on the history of training we have and that dollar figure.
With the number of people.
Yeah. Okay. In the past, it's been a couple of years since we've sent anybody to an academy-style training system, which is 220 hours. In the past, we just said, well, if you go to that, you get this much, and that was it. We weren't fully compensating for their time.
Right.
We actually need to reflect that, well, if somebody's spending 220 hours doing training, they should be compensated the same as everybody else.
Sure.
Or so at least compensated
even at,
within
even their, at the low end, that would be $2,600.
Go for the training end, yeah.
For 220 hours.
$200 at the 12, yeah.
Right. Okay. So then I do understand that historically that's been a good number, and now, and we don't want to. I don't want to get into the pay aspect of it at this point. But right. As far as paying people for the calls that they respond to, and hearing, you know, I guess some of the arguments here in the room about volunteerism, I'm not going to go into that myself. I think if it's just a simple question of whether or not people are paid for the calls that they respond to me that's not a non-issue. I think that people deserve to be paid for those types of calls. If we've agreed that this is an on-call fire department and this is what these folks do, and I guess I'm not sure what the debate is here.
Well, I think that it's if they get paid, and how much they should get paid, and how much the volunteerism and dedication to the townspeople is. I think those are the two.
That's an unknown quantity, though.
Yeah.
You can't quantify.
I'll be honest with you. I'm going to take the opposite tact. I'm going to leave all this volunteerism out.
Okay. That's yours.
Because I think your comment, with all due respect to what you're doing here, planning board and everything else, is in no comparison volunteer-wise about what the fire department goes through.
No, it's a whole different
and the police department.
Thing. I understand that.
I mean, right. You're talking about putting themselves at, I mean, there's a certain motivation to doing public service, which is great. But on the other hand, what they're doing is they're putting their lives on the line. They're putting health stuff of the garbage that they breathe, the chemicals that they're exposed to, and everything else that goes with that. Mm-hmm. And to say, well, you're doing this as very altruistically, therefore we don't have to compensate you, to me is a bogus argument.
No, I didn't say not compensate.
You know, that's like almost...
I didn't say not compensate, okay. I just...
That's almost like telling to your military, you know, we appreciate your service, but if you get shot at, you should just chalk that up because you loved your country.
Well, because firefighters have walked into this job knowing what it was when they got there. That's the difference.
The dedication of the volunteerism is how it used to be. That's what I'm saying. But don't compare the military to that, because that's years ago
might have been.
No, I understand that. But I'm talking about the military, Bob. Okay. Don't get the military.
Well, don't talk to me military, because I'm retired military and I've been there.
And you get paid, because that's a whole different animal.
Right. Okay. But the fact of the matter is that many, many years ago, when you had the fire department together, it was more, it was volunteerism. There was a social aspect to it. The families got involved, not that you don't go with it or you already do it, but I'm just saying, it was a much more county thing. Now, it's a profession, it's a technical profession, and everything else. And I think that there's a lot of other stuff that goes on now with firefighters and police that you can't give them enough money, let's put it that way. And to say, well, you came into this job knowing you're only going to get paid for training and not get paid for the call that you run into, which is probably a hell of a lot more dangerous than going to the training, okay, is to me a non-argument. I mean, that makes no sense whatsoever.
But it is what it is. You know what I'm saying?
But that doesn't mean
it doesn't mean they don't deserve to get paid.
It doesn't mean that it always that we have to perpetuate that same thing.
But by the same, just recognize it for what it is. That's all. And then if we want to change what it is, that's fine. If everybody feels the time has come to do that, you know, I appreciate the argument that it has changed from being a community effort to an actual profession. That is a good.
It is, and
it's still both. I think it's still both.
And respectfully, you know, I want to point out that yes, people do sign up on their own, but when I joined the fire department, it wasn't because I had like this, you know, like, hey, I want to see what it feels like to have my life on the line. That's not what it is.
No.
I did it because this town didn't have enough people to do it.
Yeah, you went
to
get the money either.
It was, no, you're right there. There was no money then.
Right.
But
right.
It was a lack of options. I was young. I had a close family member of mine who lives in a town that had a department very similar to ours, and their house burned to the ground before one engine got there. And I thought, geez, if any of my family members in this town ever come into that,
right.
Somebody's mm-hmm. got to be there, and I knew that our town was suffering and didn't have enough people.
Mm-hmm.
And it was from my heart that I joined that department and said, I want to be there to help. And it's not because you want, you know.
Right.
But I'm saying, what I'm saying though is like, you know, I get that they're signing up for it, you know. But I just, you know, understand sometimes it's because there's no other choice. Somebody's got to be able to do it. You know what I mean?
So the rest of the town has grown. Mm. I mean, the police station used to be in what's now the accountant and the building inspector's office. And now we have a much too small $1.3 million police station. When we were young over there, the thought that we had 24-hour police coverage was unheard of. To see the police chief back then show up in his Bronco with a blue light on at 2 in the morning was, the town's growing, and unfortunately certain aspects of it aren't. But the fire department, the fact we don't have a town manager, and we should.
But
it's an overall theme that this town is not growing to meet its customers' needs.
How much has the town actually grown? What is it in the last? As far as I know, it hasn't greatly expanded. I mean, that was the thought, even all the way back to when we redid the elementary school, and it was with the thought that the economy is booming and the town's going to go bust, and we're not going to be able to fit all these kids. When that never materialized. So I don't really know for fact how much the town has grown. I can't say it's grown exponentially from what I can tell. So I agree it has grown somewhat, but.
As a board, if we're going to try to dictate volunteerism,
mm-hmm.
I don't agree with that
at all.
That's fine. You know, bringing other aspects into it.
To tell anybody what, you know, and I think this is a sign of the times that people want to be compensated they're doing.
I agree with that.
And if people in their own minds decide that they're going to go above and beyond, mm-hmm. I'd say fantastic for them. That's a benefit to all of us. But to expect that, I think, is overstepping. And I think we should just focus on the numbers here. And as the advisory, we should only look at that, what's in the town's best interest here, and is, you know, entertaining this, the idea that every time a person is called to, you know, respond to something, that they be paid. I don't think that's in question, and should they be expected to not be paid? I don't agree with that.
I don't either. That's not, I don't think that's what any of us are saying at this board.
Reminiscing about the way things used to be.
We're going to take a vote that they get paid or not get paid.
That's what we're discussing.
Right. I'm just not convinced I understand where we're going with this recent discussion.
Okay, so let's...
Let me just go one other thing.
Yeah.
I think the only thing, personally, I'm not prepared to support this whole package.
Yeah.
I think we got to break it down. I think if we're going to start with one thing, we should take it in pieces.
That's what we're going to do.
And maybe what we should do is do the call and the training, get that taken care of.
We're doing that now, Bob. I know that. We've got three things. So we're going to take a vote on if we should get paid for calls. We're going to do that separately. That's why I just said that. We're doing three things.
All right.
So now we've got a second. Any more discussion? Okay, so let's take, the vote's going to be, should they get paid on calls, all calls?
And training, right?
And the training, yeah.
That's already in place. That's already in place. Okay, so
we seconded it. Okay, all in favor of getting paid for all calls?
Aye.
Are you Bobby?
I'm voting.
I'm sorry.
Are you saying yes or no, Steve?
I'm saying yes.
Okay, so support. Bob, are you saying yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Bobby?
No.
Okay.
I'm yes. Okay.
Okay.
Now, let's move to the next. The next one is, do we want to go from the $12 amount up to 16? Or we can find maybe a better happy medium. That's what I'm going at.
Yeah, I think you need to discuss that a little bit.
Yeah, definitely should get paid, and I'm on board with that.
I think that's a big jump.
That's a big jump.
All at once.
Yeah. Bill?
Let's see where everyone else is at.
I think 13.27.
And this is just for firefighter position, correct?
We can compare to other towns, but we also have to keep in mind what our town can do.
Because it's throwing money in there already to even, like, say, even if you kept it at training at 12, if you kept it at the $12, that's still $12 an hour that we weren't putting out before.
Right.
So I think it's a start.
I'm paying now 12.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
right. Yeah. So if we just 12, extended
right, Pete? That's what they're getting paid now?
Second page.
Okay. Yep.
To train, so.
And then in addition to that, each call.
Well, now they're going to,
right.
Before they get training for paid, now they're going to get paid for going to the calls. So that has to be factored into the figure.
And he's estimating 120 calls. At $2 an hour with an average of 6 people. Although, didn't you say generally a minimum of 8 show up? No.
As a general, we get 6 is a good average. And in terms of people that don't get paid the hourly rate, the chief and the deputy chief don't get the hourly rate. So they would factor in. So you take the 6 people that are getting the hourly rate plus the chief and the deputy chief. And 6 is a good average. Depending on, we've gone to car accidents with as few as 2.
Sure.
And yet we've gone to house fires with 14, 16.
Well, if you've needed, though, you can call for mutual aid. I imagine you have.
Yeah.
Okay.
What's your attendance speed on a fire? How many firemen show up out of the 24?
It depends on the time of day.
I know, but on an average.
Of the 24, we have a good active core of about 18. And so depending on schedules, anywhere, and again, depending on time of day, holiday, etc., anywhere from 6 to 12 is a good working number for people showing up at calls.
Uh-huh. Okay. And that's why we got mutual aid anyway. Right. So, looking for,
I hear you. What you mean. Sorry, no table talk. Of that figure?
Yes.
Okay, so.
You're putting this at.
What are you guys working on?
I'm doing that math.
That's what
it came to, 17.28.
And what do we have listed?
He's got listed 23.
But that's at 16.
No. I put it on the wrong line, sorry. That was the figure. That's how it was in 17.
So 240 times 16.
17.280.
No, he's right.
Hmm?
At 16.
Yes, but I mean, I did it at that.
Oh, I got it. I thought you had a math issue.
No.
Okay.
No.
Yeah. Where is Brimfield in relation to, as far as being similar to Brookfield and
population,
the number of calls, that you know, how far out things are spread?
In terms of towns that we do general comparisons with townwide, the two that are closest and represent here are actually Brimfield and West Brookfield. West Brookfield actually has quite a few. They're down on numbers right now. They have much less than we do on that. Call volume is about the same. Mm-hmm. I'd say about 120. Their fleet's significantly newer. So, but it's, you know, again, Brimfield, when you're doing any type of study for Brookfield, Brimfield, and people you can drive and talk to, Brimfield and West Brookfield are the two closest.
Right.
Okay. So
it's good to have at least
in
two
terms of cities. In terms of makeup, size, population, those
types
are two. West Brookfield's a little bit bigger, Brimfield's a little bit smaller, so it kind of fits.
On average, we'd be somewhere in the middle.
Yeah. And different, Brimfield fire responds to every ambulance call as well, but if you factor that out in terms of strictly fire calls, we're about on the same number wise.
Okay, thanks.
Because West Brookfield has this added tier system there.
Yeah.
So.
And again, that's, I think once we have a
moment
to work with, the personnel board is looking to implement something like that, but we needed a bottom line to know what to start with.
I'm just working through each line.
He's
sorry. Kind of, I got to say something to you guys on this board and ladies. We got a good working board here, I'll tell you. With diversified outlooks, I got to commend everybody here. I really do.
You're just injecting that. Nice.
Yes.
Thank you.
No, it's
not even 9 o'clock.
It's crazy.
I'm going to say it before I get
you guys are the ones that.
I want to say it before I get too sleepy here. But no, really,
and I expect a check in the mail tomorrow morning.
You volunteered your time, bro.
So
what figure are you guys working on?
I did it at $12 an hour.
That's now.
Just to give you an idea.
Yeah. Yep.
And it comes to $17,280.
What's that with?
For that line.
Okay.
Yes, for the call line.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
All right. They're doing other figures. I think he's looking.
Bill,
at
what are you working?
Towns.
What figure are you on?
I'm looking at individual towns and seeing what we've got for an average here. If we're somewhere between Brimfield and West Brookfield, which it sounds to me we are.
Okay.
You know, and I think I don't want to speak out of line here, but it sounds to me like everybody got a little sticker shock when they saw the 16 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's where we're a little stuck, Chief. And I don't want that to hang us up, because I don't want to be in the business of dictating wages. But if those are the towns that we're most similar to, I don't know. Could we? We're adding on the calls, so the calls are now going to be paid in addition to the training. If we met someplace as far as the hourly in between there, under less than the 16, Chief, would you think that that's something fair to open discussion?
Well, it starts a process that would go on, and for the first full year of implementation, we'd be able to reflect on just how the volume and the hours match up and where we are on that.
Okay.
It's tough to go back. And the other thing is, we're using $12 an hour. No department's been told what type of percentage increase the vast minority of the employees we're looking at. It was 3% last year. You know, I don't know if this group has discussed what the tiny little group of us are getting for that increase.
No, we haven't discussed that yet.
Yeah. Okay.
Because the firefighters, I think, would not be, in my mind, would not be subject to that.
Okay.
That would be, because we're already doing this here. I'm not willing to look at adding on calls and then also adding on a percentage, because we're already delving into an area where we've never gone before, and I think that's a pretty big step in itself.
I think we also got to be fair to other employees in this town we can't just keep comparing to other towns, because then someone could say, hey, they're getting that much, so I should get that much. And then we want a $5 increase raise. We can't go that way.
What else are we going to
do? We've got to give them an increase.
And that's why we lose a police officer every year or two.
We have to give them, well, they got a union.
That's up to them.
That's up to them. I'm saying we've got to give these guys an increase. I have no qualms about it. But we're going to be careful how we do this. Just because another town is paying this, that doesn't mean we have to. We have to do what we have to do for Brookfield, is what I'm saying.
I couldn't agree more.
The way I looked at it was, just by looking at the comparative numbers, Brentfield's 14, 16.
Give me a figure, Tony.
I rounded it to 14 between West Brookfield full-time 5 and over at 1472, 1416 for Brentfield. I did 14, that gives us 20,160. If we wanted to do a difference, 12 is the figure right now, and we've been talking 12. Mm-hmm. Maybe we do 12 for training and calls up to 5 years. Anybody over 5 years gets 15, and then it would still be a kind of a float in the middle, I think, or 14 or whatever we decided to. But I don't know how that gets set. But if we're looking at comparative towns, they're both in the 14 range. if we're trying to,
that would come into stepping right in with the personal board.
Yeah, if you did, that's what that amounts to.
No.
It's a similar structure,
right?
Because it goes by junior and how firefighter.
It wouldn't fall under stepping grade.
No, but it's along that idea.
I think we should just keep it at a set. We should keep the dollar amount at a set figure.
Yeah, too many variables running same time.
Yeah.
Well, then, if we're getting 12 for training and 16 is what's on here, then if you go right to the middle, it's 2160 is what the calls portion of that would be.
So you're talking $14 an hour?
14 is what I'm basing that on, yeah.
And that's going to be a flat fee for everything, training and on call.
Yeah, and that would put the training...
I'd keep it the same.
The training was 33,280.
Mm-hmm.
That's at 16. If we went to 14, it would be 29,120.
That was my, what I was thinking all along is sort of meeting halfway in between Brimfield and what the 16 was. See how that works? Mm-hmm. As a recommendation to move forward.
And then Tony can't say it's a thankless job. I don't think it is, Tony. Do you ever feel that way?
Huh?
You think when you went to trap me, you think it was a thankless job? Really?
Oh, I don't know.
When I see the guys, I don't think it's thankless what they do. I mean, I think this is a thankless job.
I don't know. Fireman. Well, when was the last time you walked over there and shook everybody's hand and thanked them?
Well, I haven't. I'm just saying. But inside of me,
I've supported their chicken dinners on Father's Day. Because we're not there when they get called.
Let me tell you when it is a job that's thanked. When you're, this happened a couple times. I remember when I remember being down on Quaybog Street fighting a fire at like 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
And this little lady come walking out with a tray of hot chocolates for us.
Yeah.
And come over and brought us some hot chocolates and donuts. And you know, that was so few and far between that ever happened, and it just makes you melt so happy, you know what I mean? And I'm not saying, when I say thankless, I mean for what goes on, I mean, yeah, I don't even know. I can't even thank the fire people in this town. I don't even know.
Right.
You know what I mean? I know Peter. I know Herbie. I know some of them. I know Matt. You know.
You must know Keith Conner.
Keith Conner. Yeah, I know Keith. Oh,
he was supposed to. Yeah, he told me he was gonna.
Okay, Mr. Barnes made a motion to go past 9 o'clock.
Second it. Who's gonna second it?
Yeah, I'll second it.
All right, all in favor?
All right.
Okay, so what do we got
here? Make a motion.
All right, let's hear it, Steve. We need something.
I'd like to make a motion of $14 per hour for both training and calls for all fire personnel.
And flat fee across the board?
Correct.
Okay. Somebody want to second that for discussion?
A second.
Any more discussion on that? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Bob?
Yeah.
Okay. That's unanimous. All right, now the third one, fire chief, I think, right?
Yep. Well, the other one too is the assistant chief makes a stipend.
Well, we're gonna do the both together.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so right now you're getting 3,500 roughly.
Yeah.
Okay. So you pretty much, you want to double your salary and what, just like that? You want to double it to 7, right? On you.
Just about, yeah. I mean, when you look at the comparison to other towns, that's not an unreasonable request at all. And in fact, in a couple towns, that's amazing. I should move to Peter's hand.
Yeah.
All right, let's have some, who wants to jump in and have some discussion? Or you want me to say my part?
Go ahead, if you got something, go ahead before I...
Okay, drawing a 50% increase, I'm not for that. I mean, that's my first statement. I would not be in favor of that.
That's 100%.
100%, okay.
Let's say we did this. Well, it doesn't matter. Whether it's 50% or 20% or anything else, I mean, are we exposing ourselves to people coming in going, hey, I want my raise also?
No,
I mean,
kidding.
Is that what's going on here?
Just absolutely.
You don't have another sheet.
So town assessor, you know, accountant, the this, the that, right?
That's exactly what's going on here.
Well, have we done that already with the $14 an hour? I mean, we've already...
Well, that was
done. That was
right?
Not, but that was not a huge jump.
It wasn't paid at all.
It wasn't paid.
Calls were not paid at all.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, if you want to compare the assessors, we did go up on him, but now that's a new position, so you can't compare it to that, what we did for him. That's a new position. He came in at a low rate, and he was supposed to do X number of things. Now he's taken over a lot of duties. Mm-hmm. So we don't even, that shouldn't even be in the discussion. But as far as other employees, Steve?
Yeah.
Right. We can't accept that figure. Because that's going to really start a slippery slope here.
Well, the other one on the fire chief, and not being too bold, is the personnel board has never weighed in on the fire chief's salary. And it's the only fire position that's actually rated by the personnel board.
Well, then maybe we should
go back
make
to them.
A recommendation.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with you. I'm not going to put my
stamp on that. I mean, the personnel, that's fine.
You know, I agree with you. I to me, a big jump is dangerous.
Very dangerous.
You know, and I'm not saying that it's not worth it, and we could possibly get there, but I think we even going by the 12 to the 14 is an incremental change, going up slowly, but to all of a sudden have this...
And they're not working full-time either.
Well, besides that, but I'm just saying,
but you got to put that in.
But, you know, the issue is going before the town, at the town meeting, you know, what? You know, I could see four other departments just come ballistic on you here. You know, what would be happening?
You
know,
Peter, do you get paid for trainings?
I was just going to ask that.
Huh? Yeah.
Nope.
Okay, here's something. He presently does not get paid for trainings. So, would it be a reasonable thing to start including him paid for trainings?
Exactly where I was.
Well, who's teaching?
Somewhere in the middle.
Huh?
Who's teaching?
I imagine he does the trainings.
No. Not all of it. I do some of it.
Okay, well, you'd get paid for the trainings that you...
Attend, I would think.
Participate in,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Like well,
attend, teach, yeah.
And the same thing would apply to the. Is it when you have a training? Is there one trainer, or do you?
There's a bunch of them.
No, depending on the topic, depending on the scope of it, it may be anywhere from. Reasonably one to three or four people proctoring it and assisting with it.
So
honestly, if that's the route, then doing that for both myself and the assistant chief, we could probably stay with those figures and then factor in that and just add, you know, the 52 times 4 times that towards.
The thing is, you're going with the maximum of 4. And you say it's not always 4. It can go from 2 to 3. So I've kind of
Right, but there's the intangibles of some programs off-site are 2 hours, 4 hours, 8 hours, and those are, somebody may see an offering at one of the two Mass Fire Academy and say, I really want to go to that, and it's just hard to gauge ahead of time what that's going to be. So by raising the training, by doing that to 52 weeks times 4 times 10, is just on Monday nights, it kind of factors in that once, probably every other week, somebody's attending something off-site or doing something online.
That they are not getting paid for?
No, they are. If they do something off-site, at either the two academies, they do something online, they do attend something in Sturbridge, they are getting paid.
And so you keep the record of those?
Yeah.
Each one has their own little file or something?
No, we have a master training file that they record the program and the hours.
Okay. So if they went to an 8-hour training, they'd get paid for that?
Yes. So the training one there could probably absorb the assistant chief if you did the same thing with him. Mine would just be extrapolating out if we wanted to say that, you know, 52 times 4 times that rate and add that onto the chief, then.
That comes out to be less than what the requested increase was.
Yeah. So,
by how much?
Well, it was 29.12, so 52 times 4 hours on average.
34,944 if you multiply 12 by $14 an hour.
14.
Oh, okay.
It would be 29.12, so that would be the increase that he would realize on an annual basis.
If you vote to the 12 people instead, assuming the chief and assistant chief are training, you're getting paid for training.
Okay, why would you want to put the assistant chief in with, since you've separated them out here on the paper, why would you want to put them in with the firefighters and not leave them in?
Because right now the assistant chief's wages are under the your second line on your budget, 585 or 85. The only position that's factored out in your spreadsheet is the chief. The assistant chief's comes out of
a fire.
Fire wages, yes.
It comes out of
880. Okay, I'm sorry. Yes.
Okay, so fire. Different thing. Okay. Yeah. So this would include the assistant. Mm-hmm. So you'd have to recalculate that. But, are you doing the math, Bill? Is anybody?
So the math that I'm doing is the one that says to pay the fire chief and the fire the assistant chief for training would be 52 weeks times 4 hours times $14, which comes to $2,912.
Each.
Each.
2,900 and what?
12. 29.12. That's what I'm seeing here.
So for the second line on your spreadsheet, that would be added on to the current rate, and that figure would just go into the general fire wages for the assistant chief.
We don't even have a town meeting set yet, so spending time here doing the math, we've got time to do the math. If you're agreeing on a theme, then you've got all the time in the world to extrapolate it out. We don't have a town meeting set yet, so we do have some time.
That's correct.
So they canceled it, right?
They put the Saturday decision being played on hold. And on Tuesday, they're supposed to readdress and have a different one.
And then
they could have washed it completely.
But
who's going to show up at 9:30 in the morning?
The,
I was going to.
Right now it's 12 for the assistant chief. There's nothing scheduled. So
that's right.
You were bringing coffee and donuts.
I wasn't coming.
Training.
I wasn't
going
to go.
It would be.
You do it late at night. You said
9:30 in the morning. I wasn't coming
right here.
Nope.
So what do you guys got for a figure right now?
It would go on there, but I mean on the budget sheet itself, because that's what I was.
Here's you're still doubling the you're still doubling the
that's right.
So I put that there, but I didn't.
You're still be doubling the pay, right?
Hmm?
I'm just looking over your shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, but I gotta add in that for the assistant chief to that.
So when's the last time the fire chief salary was increased, you know?
Just the incremental every year. 3% last year, a couple percent the year before.
We haven't even talked about this recruiting class, right?
Yeah, that's included, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's in here.
Chief, this recruitment class, this 16 should be a 14 now, and it has been 12, correct? So on this number, it was 12.
The chief is on separate line on the budget.
Yes.
So.
Actually, we were under benefit, that wasn't reflected because I didn't have anybody that was gonna attend. It was unknown at that point, and since we were told a level fund, we were looking at last year's figures, last year we weren't planning on it.
Okay.
So it wasn't until this year we actually have two strong candidates that will probably attend.
Okay. I'm amazed that this $21,000 number.
What is that? I don't even know what that is.
2 hours.
I don't understand even how it seems very low to me.
Well, I don't know, because to me that equals that.
Yeah, I shouldn't collect an hour's wage from the highway and collect an hour's wage from the
2 hours a month. I don't understand what that is, so I think we need to get that clarified.
Another thing, we got another problem is this salary, this chief salary is a salary, it's not a wage. So now we're trying to implement wages into the salary, and you can't do that.
Well, no, it's...
Well, that's what we're
no,
doing.
Well, no, we're paying him for... Okay.
You can't.
So then you would leave it at that, leave wage, salary as salary, and then just put plus $14 per training. Yeah, some of these other things have incorporated. I'm looking, they do have...
Salary is salary, can't... Have salary plus
wages. No, I know, but they've got stipend, which is salary, plus hourly training. If you look at the where it says, say, West Brookfield, that's how they did it.
Peterson.
They did it, they kept the stipend, but they added the training.
Plus inspections. Definitely done by a lot of people, yeah.
What's that thing?
The stipend plus hourly, it's on here a lot. But I think it could be pulled off. I don't think it's something we...
Stipend and salary are two different
if
things.
Leave the stipend...
I'm just bringing that up to make sure okay. that...
Yeah, and just add in the hourly for the training.
Does not raise stipend.
That's correct.
Okay.
Stipend is stipend, salary is salary.
All right.
Big difference.
So it was, you're suggesting it should stay at 34.76 for the stipend? And then we would add
salary. That right now, that's what he's.
Well,
salary.
Whatever stipend. Yeah. The other towns are treating it as a stipend. You're calling it a stipend.
We're calling it a salary in our town. We got to stick to what we're doing
it's
in our town.
As a
okay, so stipends
town.
Don't get increases. Salaries do.
Correct.
Okay.
That's the difference.
All right. So, do you want to increase his salary? Or
well, that's what we have to. Right, we have to do that. In a certain way.
Well, that's why I was talking about.
You can't put wages in you know, plus the salary. You can't do it. That's like someone on salary can't get overtime. Can't.
This is true.
Without being too self-serving, can I suggest something?
Can't be paid by two departments at the same time.
If your principal is to pay the fire chief for training, but not set up two different systems,
okay.
Then if you take the 34.76 and then do the math out. 52 times 4 times 14 and add that to it, you create a salary in essence. Yeah, so you pay me for training de facto by just coming up with that figure and applying it to it.
Well, but they're two separate things though. So that would, like say next year we decided to go to 15. But we didn't want to increase the salary, we just wanted to increase training pay. If you lump it all together, then you're getting paid more for both.
Right, but in so, subsequent years, what you could do is you could look at the percentage of increase on one point and then apply that or not apply that to different positions.
Well, haven't you figured in, yeah, the other thing with salary, you've already, generally you figure in roughly a 3% increase every year. So there's your salary
well,
increase.
Well, the last 3 years, not...
Well, whatever, I'm
okay.
just saying,
I'm just, yeah, I just want
to clarify that, right. That's fine, but, so salary already gets increases, generally speaking. So, we're looking at just adding training.
So again, if you do the 52 times 4 times 14, that number added to the 3476, mm-hmm. and in essence...
No, because then when you get a rate, when you get an increase, it'll be based... People that are looking at it are going to base that 3% or 2% or 1% on the whole amount that's there. They're not looking at it the way we're looking at it, and it's just going to confuse the public. Mm-hmm. Because they're going to say, well, why is he... It seems like you're saying he's getting 3, but it looks like he's only getting 2. They're not going to understand. They haven't been through all this, so...
What happened to the original premise that we go back and put the request into personnel that they do an evaluation of the damn position?
Well, I think that's where I want to go.
And that's down the road. Yeah. I don't think we're going to be able to tackle that at this point in the calendar year.
Well, we've been doing it with every other position.
No, we got time to do it. Yeah, we can have this whole thing done except for that.
At grade 16.
So what's that, Bob?
The fire chief is presently at grade 16 with the personnel board.
Okay, on a piece of paper.
Which equates to how much?
It's
3,000.
This doesn't apply.
I'm just telling you the step. Agree.
Mm-hmm. We also can't just say, oh, we're going to double somebody's salary. I mean, no matter how you figure it, I'm not on board with that.
No.
Currently, and I'll let someone else make that decision, but I'm not going to make that decision.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm. What is it?
It's currently at grade.
He's 6. He's at 16.
16. Okay.
By the personnel board.
Which equates to how much money? Which equates to how much money?
There's no monetary
that's the top, right?
Value listed. So
they have not got that stuff upgraded.
That step and grade thing is garbage.
We do have.
It is. I agree. It's just.
We do have a fire wage line.
It's a gauge, maybe. It's a gauge, but.
Okay, we have a fire wage line.
At a salary.
Why couldn't your wages for training be included in the fire wages?
That would be up to you. It's an option.
That's what he gets paid as a fire chief. That's salary.
But that's separate. Yes.
Now you're double dipping.
It's right. Not double dipping.
Double dipping is getting.
It's not. Paid it's twice paying for one him job. For training.
If we're going to increase the line for salary, we just have to increase the line for salary, and you can figure out how you want to figure it out, and then put the increase into the salary, and then he would be paid for training, but...
But it would have to be a flat rate.
It'd be a flat salary rate.
Because we're figuring 120...
What if you change the salary to a stipend, and then you can't get an increase at that point because it's a stipend, but your increase would come out of the
hourly rate. I don't know that we can do that.
I didn't know. That's what I was asking.
Yeah,
I
don't can't do that. Do
okay.
So...
that idea.
Well, let me ask this. So you can't make a living off of 3476 a year, right?
No, I don't. No, but that's, yeah.
He doesn't. Right?
Hopefully everybody will be able to see where I'm going with this. So you're drawing a wage based on the duties that you perform, which are as an EMT,
full-time paramedic,
as a full-time paramedic firefighter.
Yeah.
As the fire chief.
You
are drawing $34.76 per year, which is meted out throughout the year.
Quarterly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's in addition to, and I don't necessarily think that this is a case of double dipping. I don't see it as such, unless it can be explained where that is the case. Is that what we're seeing here? Is that because we've got a salary and then we've got wages on top of that. Is
you
that
can't
what
do that.
Is that what we're that, talking
that's
about?
Not double dipping though.
No, it isn't. No. So
Peter, what is your total, what do you make between the EMT and being the fire chief?
With overtime last year was 62. Thereabouts.
I thought it was
63. 62, 63. I don't recall.
Let's say.
I just
mailed in my W-2 and I didn't.
You get one W-2?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, everybody into even officers that do details or you do multiple positions, you only get the one.
I see the salary as as an additional item that is included because of those duties mm-hmm. that someone would perform when you're an EMT firefighter, if you are the chief, well then because of those duties you get this $34.76. Right.
There's 108 hours a week I'm not compensated.
Okay.
My full time is 60 hours a week. The other 108 hours a week, then it's, that's where the 34.76 comes out.
So, what is your? I'm just the EMT and the fire chief is around 65 a year, 68.
If I recall.
Huh?
Something. If that's the annual.
No, I'm trying to. I haven't found it yet.
Listed in the back of the annual report? Is that where everybody's wages? I mean, that's a year old, but. Is anybody listed in the back of that?
No, not on this one anyway.
No.
I saw it listed somewhere.
Yeah. There was an annual report around.
Yeah.
And I guess the point that I think I understand too is if you increase that by 100% to 7,000, you're probably going to generate a fair amount of. Discussion.
Something.
But again, it's not about discussion.
It's a small amount, and I agree. $3,500 is not a lot of money, you know, and if that's what we're basing. Not right, exactly. And I think the point being that it's the perception of that increase.
Yeah, my eyes were open just by looking at some of my counterparts and Hardwork, Petersham, Spencer, he's full time, and that's a contractual thing. But,
Right, exactly. That's a different system.
Two is 240.
All right. So, what are you guys coming up with? We're gonna send it over to the personnel board. Is that what you? That's what you all seem to be heading towards.
Yeah, I believe it. I think they're meeting next week, and they were going to talk about it anyway.
So who does like reviews and stuff? Do the personnel board do that?
What
does?
What?
I don't know.
Do the.
What does the personnel board do in this regard? What will the personnel board?
Well, they're supposed to be writing up a new step and grade at some point.
Job descriptions.
Okay.
Wage increases, if need be, all that type of stuff. Yeah.
They're very active right now. They're working on an employee handbook. They're working on a department head's handbook. And
are they the people who would say $34,076 isn't enough? We need to bump that up to, $6,000? I mean, are they...
It would be more of a recommendation. They don't have any regulatory or control over it. But
and they go by the stuff and grade, right?
Yeah.
And then we're supposed to weigh in on and give our recommendation. I mean, we're talking such a huge increase here. It's just,
Well,
we have to be careful.
Right. We're talking about this. This 29 is. I'm not quite sure what it is, but it's.
You're going to double
it's more than 50%.
No. Yeah.
Almost doubling it.
Well.
No. I'm.
Right? Is that what you're going?
No, I'm.
That's not a true figure. It's higher than that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, what was?
Because that's 15, so.
That's calendar year.
Well, the 29 I was talking about putting in was just.
By now, right?
You said that on your paycheck, you can have different functions in town that you get paid for, but it all comes on one paycheck.
Yes.
Okay. So.
Well, you get different paychecks, don't you, Pete?
No.
Okay. Oh. So it's probably listed there per department.
No,
what you're getting?
It's listed by rate and hours.
Yeah.
It's not by department.
Okay, well, that's what I mean. So this would be a fire department wage if we paid for training. So why wouldn't that just be another line on your, on his?
Yeah.
So we got almost 64 in 015 total. Okay. Yeah, that makes a difference then.
Well,
yeah, that's EMT and being the fire chief.
Right?
And you get some from BEMA, don't you get some from BEMA too?
I'm sorry, what? Why is that figure not right, Bob?
Huh?
You said that figure's not right.
That figure's not right. That goes back into last year.
015, right?
That's calendar.
Right, okay. That figure's right for where it was.
You got more than that.
No, I didn't.
No, look at just W-2.
Okay.
and see what you got.
But it gives us a gauge of...
It's an idea.
That's what I...
No, it's not an idea. That's how much I made that year.
Oh, 15.
It gives you something to look at previous to this year.
Right.
That's all.
So where are we going with this?
I'm just saying, Mr. Barnes is calling in that the treasurer didn't do her job, so...
All right, so what do you want to do? Put this on the table and ship it over to the personnel board and let them weigh in on it?
We're gonna follow a methodology that we've done with other positions, send it over to the personnel board, so that we have what Bobby always recommends, is that look at what it comes out to, let's get some recommendations from them as to where to then go from there.
Right.
Because right now, we're swinging in the breeze, to be very honest with you.
Right now, the figures you came up with, the swinging in the breeze, you're almost doubling this figure, and I'm not going to put a stamp on that. I mean...
Well, let's qualify it. If the...
Let the personnel board weigh in on it.
If they came in with a recommendation at that level...
Then we'll go from there.
For whatever reason, then we have something to put our legs on. Right now, we don't.
Okay. And that's why we're going to ship it over to them.
Now, just one other thing I just wanted to clarify, that a statement was made about 108 weeks, hours a week that you are not paid for. I'm guessing that's being on call?
No, I'm available for my full-time duties 60 hours a week.
And that's, EMT?
Yes.
And so?
So the nights and weekends, I'm still the fire chief. So the 3476 covers inherently weekends, nights, and just to exist, not counting training, meetings.
Right. So that's to be available for on-call.
Yeah, the police chief.
But as it turns out, your pretty consistent estimation for the last couple of years has been an estimation of 120 calls at an average of 2 hours. So over the course of a year, it kind of boils down to around 240 hours total in the year as is related to going to calls.
For calls, yeah.
Yes.
Calls, inspections, meetings.
So in as much as, the 108 hours, is there, it exists, but average, generally speaking, you'd be probably called for about 240 hours to, barring some major catastrophe. All right, so we're going to send it over to personnel to ask them for a recommendation or...
To review.
They came back with Al's grade, and they came back with a number.
Right, review.
Give me a number.
Okay.
Give me a number.
Right. Okay, I'm just wondering where you were coming from on that.
Those water bars getting fired up.
No, it's 9:30, and we've beaten this to death here.
Okay.
And it's been a long day.
So, are you going to? Are you on personnel?
No, but I'm gonna.
You won't be here for the last one, so.
I'm gonna put down that you really wish we
did. I'm trying to catch up.
You really wish we started it 5 years ago.
Okay. I don't think we're gonna solve it tonight.
No,
we can't because we're sending it over to the personnel board.
And we're not gonna make up 5 years worth of history in one blow either.
Okay, so one piece of the
story. That's what we're gonna do with that, and we can't, so we got everything else pretty much.
Well, there's one other thing, because we haven't even gotten into the lower half of Chief Martell's original budget, which included the fire expenses and fire recurring and things like that.
We haven't done that, no.
One of the things that we asked Chief Martell for was a detail of expenses, which is something we weren't able to produce tonight.
Can you have it for Monday, Pete?
I
can try to.
Sure. So in other words, can we have that?
Yeah.
Great.
I can break down it's simply a question of taking the ledger.
Great. And then we can get this budget approved get a hold of personnel. Even if we have to do everything but that, we can still get
it. That's great. Right.
Now, one little question on here. I was talking to Bill about it, and I didn't quite understand what it is. The line that says assigned duties, because we just incorporated training and calls together. So what is the assigned duties line?
There are personnel that take on duties above and beyond. Trucks have assigned test drivers where they'll go through a checklist, check the oil, check the brakes, check the lights, etc.
Mm-hmm.
We have the lieutenant who coordinates training, the person who does IT internally, the person who updates the website. Things that just kind of fall out of the blue collar scope of, well, not the mechanical,
But up until now, where has that cost been?
In wages.
In wages.
Yes, that's always been there, and that's factored in at 2 hours a month. So it's generally more, but they're just comfortable that they're coming up on a Saturday morning, checking the oil on the trucks.
Yep.
2 hours a month's a reason.
All right, sounds good.
I'm just gonna ask this, so other than the fire chief, every single other consideration here, group class, assigned duties, training, calls, assistant chief, we're in that $21,500 line.
Line 880, whatever that brings out to now. Yep.
With these same calculations, you know, 12 positions,
2 hours a month.
2 hours a month.
Yep.
Same calculation, different rates.
That's good to, I'll add it to mine.
Because we're going to go up.
Give me a cell phone number.
It's, well, mostly it's just $2 an hour. So it's 14%.
Okay.
So it's not.
Okay, I'm just about to add it up. And I'm not gonna add this calls.
No, because calls is separate.
It was never there. Right. I'm just trying to look at this.
I can still remember all my friends going to this when I was a kid, but I can't even tell you my wife's phone number.
Okay.
Right. Oh, ridiculous. It's all on him.
We don't have to vote on this, do we?
No.
See, this is what I'm saying. Here's training.
No, we're not going to vote on it.
52 weeks times 4 times 10 people.
We have to march in a parade?
Times 10, 12 of those hours. There's $24,000 right
there.
That was
in the box, right? I'm already. All a copy.
Greater than, right. Just going up to $2.
No, you don't have to match your grade.
No, I'm saying I just multiply it by 12.
I mean, we're not going to have an assessor float or something like that?
I'm thinking, Tony.
Or I mean, an advisory float?
I'm not sure if it's fine.
Or go through us.gov.
Go on the back of your truck.
Only because.
This is the longest, this is the only discussion we've had on this advisory.
That are not.
Okay.
So it's, I'm certain things. I've noticed that happening in the past. So you wouldn't want that on your business email.
I can already tell you, this is going to come back.
That is your personal?
I set that up for my exit email, just to give them.
I'm not even looking for answering me, I don't have
access. Okay, very good.
It would be, how do you get that number?
What are you guys working out?
I'd like to just, with all, you know, I know we're all, it's late. Right. All of this right here, okay, accounts for line 880 and 885.
Right.
Okay. So, what I've just asked that. Chief Martell is this: if you take, and I've asked Chief Martell. So, you know, 12 positions times 24, 2 hours per month. Okay, 52 weeks times 4 hours times 12 people times 12. All this should add up to $21,000. Okay?
So I just
took the training line. 52 weeks times 4 hours times 10 people, and I multiplied by 12, the current rate, and it came to $24,000. We're already... So where did this $21,000 number come from?
That was local funder from last year.
That was... Chief, what I'm saying to you, sir, is this $21,500, I have no idea where you came from it, because if what you're saying is that number, that 21.5, accounts for everything on this page except for your line.
No, the 21.5 is just level funded from last year at $12 an hour just for training. Because we were just told the level fund and that we'd be approached to talk about increases.
Okay. Maybe we're all tired.
Here we are.
Okay.
Keep that on top of you.
Oh, don't worry, because I know it's gonna come back.
Yeah.
Okay. So okay.
All right, someone wanna make a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. There will be no discussion, so I won't entertain that. You can't have a discussion.
I just like to let you
all in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
Bill, you want to say something?
I got nothing.
Like to let you know that we just military launched airstrikes on Syria.
They what?
United States just launched airstrikes on Syria. Government.